Over the last 10 years, Time Team have dug lots of Bronze Age sites. We've uncovered everything from burial mounds and grave goods to elaborate trackways and entire communities. It's a fantastic picture, far richer than the one we previously had. But after a decade of amazing finds in the fields and back gardens of rural and urban Britain, we've decided it's time to re-examine what we've learnt. So now we bring you the best of our discoveries in Time Team Digs the Bronze Age. In 1990, someone flew over this Worcestershire field and took this aerial photograph. You can see all these extraordinary crop marks that aren't visible from the ground. But what are they? Well, we've got two clues. A couple of fields in this direction, archaeologists have discovered vast amounts of pottery and evidence of houses and deep pits, all of it Bronze Age, and in such large amounts, it's considered to be of national importance. The challenge was interpreting all these lines. Could this have been a building, or was it a ditch surrounding a settlement? Were these rubbish pits? And might this have been some type of trackway? Trench 1 went in over the ditch. And straight away, Phil found a beautiful Neolithic axe head.
I gather you've had a find as well.
Come on, travels fast, look at that. Oh dear me.
Oh, what? You mean dear me? you know what that is though, don't you?
Yeah, it's an offhand axe, isn't it?
That is. Yeah. I mean, well, you can imagine, I feel pretty chuffed about that. You don't
really? You do surprise.
Yeah, but look, you don't get many hand axes round here, do you?
Well, you do now.
And I mean, let's be honest.
It's called the hardening factor.
Isn't this the oldest man-made implement we've ever found?
So
and here it was, just lying on the topsoil.
Yeah. You presumably look for the rest of it.
Oh, what? If I can find the rest of it.
As Phil thought, this piece of flint was the oldest man-made item we'd ever found on Time Team. It showed that people were here well before the Bronze Age. What is a crop mark, Mick?
Well, it's a mark you see from the air in the crops that might or might not indicate archaeology. But I can show you best with the diagram. If we take a surface of the ground and we've got a big pit dug into it, and let's say this is limestone or gravel or some well-drained soil like that, then this is full of gunge and you know, filled up with soil and all the rest of it. When you put a crop over the top of that, what tends to happen is that crop will grow, but where it grows over that ditch, it'll be very much taller because it's drawing on a greater depth of plant nutrients to give a richer crop. And then when it ripens, this bit of the crop will stay greener longer than the rest when it's ripening because it's drawing from a greater depth of moisture and so on in the ditch. And so if you happen to be flying over at the right time and the crop happens to be registering that effect, then you'll see these dark lines from the air. And of course you can get the opposite effect, which is if you've got, for example, a Roman villa or a Roman road, and so you've got stonework in the soil, then the crop growing in the field there will be stunted.
It'll be smaller, yeah.
Yeah, be stunted over as it grows over that stonework, and then when it's ripening, that bit of the crop will wither and go yellow before the rest of the crop. So you might see, you know, white lines in your crop, or light lines.
The lower half of your face looks like that, actually.
Down the road, half a mile away at a sewage works, there was another crop mark that interested us. These are sewage tanks. But what were these lines? Why do we want to look at this when it's so far away from the rest of the site?
Well, essentially it's a trackway, which was for getting animals, and people probably, from an area of farms over there,
yeah,
along the edge of the river, towards the site that we're going to be working on. So, I mean, they may be closely connected. It may be the same people using it.
Victor's drawn his idea of a Bronze Age trackway. Francis went one better and took me to a nearby lane.
It's as good an exact parallel for a Bronze Age trackway as I can think. This one's actually running down to the river. But you've got ditches on the side. There's one down here. It's got a bit shallow now. It would originally have been much deeper, and it's still holding water. And then instead of a lathe hedge, we have a fence on the side, but basically the points to keep the animals in.
So who would have made the decision to create this?
Whoever made those decisions made them in consultation with other people, because this landscape isn't laid out piecemeal. It's not one man and his dog fetching some livestock down to the river. It's a carefully organised landscape.
So although trackways like this look pretty idyllic to us today, there's actually local politics at work.
Local politics, and this is a working landscape.
Mick opened up a trench to look for the trackway which was on the aerial pictures, and throughout the day it just got bigger and bigger. What is it then?
Okay, well, let me put you in the picture, and you, Tony, as well. This is our enclosure ditch.
Yeah.
With one side coming along there, and the other side you're coming along there. Okay? And that comes up to our trackway, which is running off there on that side. On this side, here's the other side of the trackway.
Not coming right through.
That's right, you can see that.
Yeah.
And look what it's got on the outside of it. A nice parallel flanking ditch.
Yep.
So that is what we were seeing on a geophysics.
So we found our trackway, and we can imagine how it would have looked. In the main field, we also discovered that there was an Iron Age house here, probably a farm. Next to it, we think there was a larger settlement which we could date to the Iron Age. But back at Trench 1, Malcolm had made a remarkable discovery.
And look at those. Oh, crikey, look at that. Well, I know what that is. I mean, that's a nice flint scraper. But what's this?
Well, that's a piece of beaker pottery.
Get out.
So that goes back to 2000 BC.
Yeah, I wouldn't recognise that at all.
So this is the earliest pottery we've had from the site.
Crikey, so there's something early Bronze Age on the site. I mean, but
that's right. And then we've got a gap of about 1500 years before we go on to the Iron Age site.
This piece of pot revealed that there were people living here at Kemerton in the very early Bronze Age, around 2000 BC. When did people first put together this new material called bronze and realise that it would make great tools?
So far as this country goes, probably about 4,500 years ago. And strictly speaking, they started with copper before they turned to bronze. And in fact, on the continent, people normally talk about a copper age, which is a term that's never caught on in this country.
Once we're in the Bronze Age, did everything sort of stay the same?
No, there's a very big change. For a start, it's unlikely that the first metal had an enormous impact in practical terms. People went on using stone far more than they used metal. It's only halfway through the period that you really get the development of a varied toolkit that performs most sorts of useful functions. And at much the same time, the archaeology as a whole changes. In the first half of the Bronze Age, it's much easier to talk about burials, to talk about ritual sites, stone circles, and the like. In the later half, there's much more evidence for settlements, houses, field systems, land boundaries, and even the very beginning of hill forts.
At Wadden in Dorset, we again found ourselves on the trail of a prehistoric settlement that must have been occupied over many centuries. The evidence was in the profusion of lumps and bumps in this aerial photograph, and particularly in these gardens. The owners had amassed a tantalising collection of medieval, Roman and Iron Age pottery. While surveying the landscape, Stuart noticed several features worth a closer look. There were two trackways showing up on the side of the ridge. This one he thought was medieval, but the higher one was older. Why? Because this medieval field boundary goes right over it. This prehistoric track, which could be Iron Age, led to another earthwork, which Stuart was excited by.
And this is that curved enclosure that I was badgering you about.
Yeah.
That is an earthwork, Don't understand what it is, but this trackway heads towards it.
By day three, we dug a huge trench across the circular earthwork.
Good God! Some of the foundations for a hotel or something.
Why did you dig so deep?
Following the fill.
What, this sticky clay stuff?
This cut down there.
That's all fill, that's not just natural.
No. What it is an enormous ditch, huge, with a bank on this side.
Hang on a minute, the ditch is going that way.
Yeah. We kept pursuing it because there was clearly an earthwork here. We had to keep going with it. And what we've ended up with is this huge ditch on the inside, the big curved earthwork.
I only know one thing that has a big ditch on the inside and the bank on the outside, and I don't really believe what I'm hearing.
Well, what is it?
We think the dimensions and everything are right for it being a henge, which is a late Neolithic ceremonial monument.
Yeah. If that's right, that's a mega find, isn't it?
Mick, if it's a henge, that doesn't necessarily mean there's going to be big bits of stone lying around, does it?
No, because a lot of them had timber settings inside or indeed no obvious features inside.
And am I right in saying that henge building was about the same time as the early pyramids?
Yeah, we're talking about 2500 BC in round figures.
So we've actually moved the habitation of this area back another 1,000 years.
That's what it looks like. I think we need to do a lot more work today to try and clarify
it. So we're not going to get excited?
Yeah, we are. Oh, yeah, we're excited.
A big ditch on the inside of a huge bank is a combination that's only found on henge monuments, which is why we were still confident about our discovery. And as henges only occur in the Neolithic and Early Bronze Ages, it must mean that Wadden Henge was built sometime between 2500 and 1000 BC. So what started with pottery finds in one garden resulted in a whole landscape being revealed. A landscape which told the story of the continual occupation of Wadden for over 4,000 years. In 1999, archaeologists discovered a 4,000-year-old wooden henge on the coast of Norfolk. It was a supremely important find, and one that could yield fascinating information about the Bronze Age. Who'd built it, how, when, and why? The only way to get those answers was to dig it up before the sea destroyed the precious evidence forever. So English Heritage decided to remove the entire monument, and Time Team filmed the extraordinary excavation. Sea Henge, as it became known, was a large tree stump, mysteriously buried upside down, surrounded by a ring of timbers. It was originally a mile inland, but then it was claimed by the sea. The sand and mud that had protected it had now been washed away. Working with the archaeologists were Francis Pryor and Maisie Taylor from the Flag Fen Bronze Age Centre. The tide was on our side and the team were ready to lift the first of 56 prehistoric timbers.
The tension mounts, as they say.
But the wood was extremely delicate and the 3 feet thick alluvial mud into which each one was buried had to be removed very carefully.
Mark!
Well, over here.
As the first timber came out, we could see that the mud had preserved the wood perfectly. But as the archaeologists battled to save the henge, another threat emerged. Local protesters were gathering to try and prevent the excavation.
You've got as much right to be here, and if you don't, you know, if you're at odds about what they're doing, they've got a job to do, but, you know, if you've got as much right to
say... As far as I'm concerned, you see...
You don't agree with it, but as long as it's done in a peaceful way, as you appreciate.
We don't need to nick their circle, we got them now. We still build them. There's still geezers wandering around building them. Yeah.
The protesters were enraged that a chainsaw had been used to get a wood sample, but at least it had led to an accurate date.
I combined the relative dating that we produced from tree rings with the absolute dating from radiocarbon, so we can actually say that the central tree stump was felled or died in 2050 BC, and that the circle went up around it the next year in the spring, between April and June of 2049 BC.
Because the circle's been submerged for so long, it's eroded and bits have broken off. Certainly looks very different from how it would have done when it was first built. So Time Team are going to attempt a full-scale reconstruction of the original in all its glory, but using only Bronze Age technology.
That one over there.
No
noble tree, isn't it?
It's
eh?
A heck of a size.
Yeah, it should be just about right.
Using replicas of a Bronze Age axe found at Flag Fen, we started to fell the tree that we'd chosen for the centrepiece of our replica henge.
Look how it's going! Get back! Exactly!
Brilliant! Now all they had to do was dig out the stump. The excavated timbers were being preserved at the Flag Fen Bronze Age Centre.
Come and have a look at this, Damien.
Oh, I can't resist. Water's cold. That is superb.
Isn't that good?
And they are big. They are really big.
And we would expect then that all these marks would be made by the same axe?
Each axe had left its own unique cut mark on the tree stump, so we could even work out how many people it took to chop it down. At the excavation site, the battle over the archaeology heated up.
And stop work and try to stop any more destruction to this, then we can come to some mutual happy.
Because I think that's what we're both trying to get to the same place, aren't we? Some understanding.
Understanding, yeah. That's it. But by destroying it, by taking it away from this place, this specific point on the land, by cutting pieces out of it and taking down the outer circle, is not going to help us really understand it at a deeper level. It might help on the intellectual level, this bit was dated to such and such a day, but not to really understand why us here and what the motivation was by putting it there and such like, really.
So is it going to, there's some demonstrable way in which this monument can be understood by leaving it on the beach?
Most definitely. Most definitely in working with it as a circle, you know, like other sacred sites around the country.
Mm. What's interesting is that the people who are objecting to us digging the circle don't actually seem to want to know any more about it. And they seem to think that just by existing, it's got some sort of force, which possibly was true for the people who built it.
At last, the archaeologists could begin removing the great inverted tree stump. It was the defining moment. Could the 4,000-year-old tree bole withstand a lift, or would it simply fall to pieces, along with whatever secrets it held?
I'm more worried about the tree that it's going to come out safely. It's been there a long time.
At Flag Fen, Phil and Carenza inspected the enormous tree stump as it lay in a specially constructed water tank.
What's it weigh?
Well, we estimated between 2 and 2.5 tons.
Coral is even more honeysuckle around here.
Oh, yeah.
So this is the first time this has seen the light of the day for, 4,000 years?
That's right. The last person who saw this was the person who put the tree in the hole.
Gosh.
Around one side of the tree were strands of honeysuckle twisted into rope, which appeared to have been threaded through a hole specially cut in the side of the stump. That's how they'd have dragged the 2-ton stump into its resting place.
Right, just hold up there.
If honeysuckle rope was good enough for the job 4,000 years ago, it had to be good enough for us today.
Good job! Stop.
Okay.
So everyone on the team was roped in to drag the tree into its waiting hole. As long as those Bronze Age ropes held.
No, we're okay. Get some skids ready.
Come on, keep it going.
Keep it going.
Keep going.
Slow.
What?
Oh. The moment of conception is nigh.
Now tell me this isn't a fertility symbol.
Could get the rollers out the way. Oh, hang on.
Go in. This is going to be a couple of inches further forward.
Yeah.
With the central stump in place, it was now time to position the circle of 56 timbers around it. Damien, what do you reckon it was?
I don't know. I mean, we've been focusing on getting the thing up in time. That's been our main concern at the moment.
You know, what but do you get thinking. A feeling of it?
Yes, fatigue. No. It is weird. I mean, when you look at that stump inverted, that is a most, most weird thing. I think the symbolism of the spring felled oak going into the earth is pretty solid.
How do you feel about that?
I think that's a terribly male perspective, that is. That's typical the idea. It's a big male fertilisation thing. I think it's all about containing the tree. I think it's almost disposing of the tree. It's something, the tree is being neutralised almost. It's much more like getting rid of it. It's a burial for the tree.
It's not the geographical place that's weird. It's the circle that's weird and the tree stump that's weird. And we didn't create it. It's created itself.
It's a very interesting sort of fenced-in area, this. And, I'm a pretty cold-blooded character about these, but, you know, a big tree in a space like this does feel very strange. It's like almost like a prison, but you can see through it. And from the outside, you can just see this through the slots.
A specially built structure to do with death and the migration of a soul into the next world. So it was partly to contain that special journey that they put that wall around. What went on the central tree, I don't know, but it's deliberately going down. The tree is a sort of symbol of life, and it's pointing down to another world below the surface. But I think what is amazing about this reconstruction is it really gets your brain going.
After all these months of sweat and hard labour, this is the closest approximation we can get to what this wooden circle would have looked like 4,000 years ago. And it's only when you come inside it that you begin to get some kind of feeling of why those Bronze Age people would have been prepared to invest such an enormous amount of labour with such rudimentary tools in chopping that big tree down, lugging it however far they lugged it, and then inverting it and dropping it into this big hole. Because whatever it was for, it still has an enormous sense of power and mystery around it. Flag Fen near Peterborough. 3,000 years ago, a wooden trackway ran across the watery fenland to gnaw the island. Francis Pryor had spent many years excavating it.
It was much more than a walkway. It was a way across the fen, but it was also a barrier, it was a defensive wall, and it was a place where people offered the most incredibly valuable items into the waters.
When they excavated the trackway at the mainland end under this power station, they found hundreds of bronze artefacts which had been dropped into the water. Most of the objects seem to have been placed in the water on the landward side of the trackway. In the Bronze Age, these objects must have been really valuable. So why would people throw them into the water?
That's the sort, this is broken, isn't it? Was it like that when you found it?
Yes, yeah, actually we found this bit, which joins on there, obviously, about sort of a metre away. It wasn't very far away at all. It's been broken to take it out of this world, to make it an item for the next world.
So these beautiful bronze objects were votive offerings, ritually broken and dropped into the water to honour the dead, or maybe to appease gods. But was there any relationship between this trackway and the round barrow further up the slope on the dry ground on Northey Island? Were they being used at the same time? What is a round barrow?
It's a Bronze Age burial mound, and it literally would have been a mound of dirt. I mean, now it's ploughed completely flat, so you hardly see it. But the fact is that it's going to be there, and whoever was buried inside was probably somebody of pretty good status. Francis? Look at that edge.
Oh, that's spot on.
After a day's fruitless digging, Phil finally found the ring ditch around the Bronze Age barrow.
That's it, all right, isn't it?
Beautiful edge.
And then look, on the side here, chop that up a bit, and you've got the...
Looks like you've got a cut coming down there too, yeah.
Yeah, look, you've got the bank, I think, that went round the edge.
Inside our trench, this is the section of the barrow we could see. It told us that originally the barrow would have looked like this. We then took the trench off at a new angle to pick up another section of the ring ditch. This is definitely a ring ditch.
Yeah.
But how do you know that it's Bronze Age?
Look at this. Not only would you know it's Bronze Age, but that must be associated with a body. Such high quality.
Is that an arrowhead?
Big triangular arrowhead.
Beautiful, isn't it? Without question, this flint arrowhead was a beautiful artefact with exquisite ripple flaking. But more importantly for us, it was evidence that dated the first use of the barrow to the early Bronze Age, about 2000 BC. And in the middle of the barrow, we finally uncovered a cremation burial. Doesn't look nearly as exciting as I thought it would have. It just looks like a little step in the trench.
It's very exciting.
Why?
What I've got here is actually somebody's tooth. That's fractured dental enamel. During the cremation process, the dentine inside the tooth expands and the enamel on the outside fractures and breaks off.
That's a gory thing in there. They're actually burning a body. You know, it's a cremation, which they did. And what they did was they burned the body, then they moved the ashes over to the barrow. So that's where we've been excavating.
We think the barrow stood on the site of a Bronze Age house, and after the inhabitants died, it probably became their burial site. Although there were few finds here, elsewhere there have been some remarkable discoveries. This is such a beautiful pot, isn't it? How old do you think it is?
I think it's probably been over 4,000 years old.
It's so precious, this. And it was found in a grave, wasn't
it? Yeah, that's right.
What do we know about burial practices in the Bronze Age?
Well, in the first part of the Bronze Age, people often build mounds. They put individuals in with a selection of objects, metal, pottery, other substances. The earlier graves, they put them in as whole bodies. The later ones, they cremate them. And any one mound probably has a whole succession of deposits. They're not just built for one person. One barrow might have something between 20 and 30 burials in it.
When you say deposits, it's not just pots and ashes, is it?
No, it's not. You have pottery, you have metalwork as well, you have personal ornaments, you have weaponry. For example, daggers are very common in male graves.
Did people put these grave gifts into burials all the way through the Bronze Age?
No. As you get the big change around 1500, the burial mounds become smaller and eventually they virtually disappear from the archaeological record. What happens instead is the types of metal that would normally have been associated with the dead in earlier periods are separated from the ashes and put in other places.
Like where?
Particularly in water.
Water used to dominate this landscape at Grey Lake in the Somerset Levels. We were looking for a Bronze Age wooden trackway built over the marshes. This is how the area looks today. Using the evidence from a dig here in 1926 and the fact that more wooden piles were found here in 1939, archaeologists believed that a prehistoric trackway crossed the marsh in this direction, bridging the gap between these two areas of high ground. Halfway through day one, and Phil thought he'd already found one of those posts.
Oh, what's
look
this?
Look at that. Well, this is a timber here, look, kind of sticking up. And that bit's just a flake off the top of it.
Can I get in the trench?
Yeah, yeah. Come in, it's just big enough.
Well, how do you know that that is not just some old bit of log?
We don't.
No, yet. But I mean, the fact is, it's diving straight down.
This wood it's really spongy.
Yeah.
Would it really have lasted thousands of years?
Well, you see the water coming out of that. Look.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Tony, look at it down further, though. That bit has come off the top here. That's where it's really spongy. Can you hear it?
Oh, that's good.
That's firm.
That bodes well for a date as well, doesn't it?
It looked like we'd found the trackway with our first trench. This was Victor's impression of what a Bronze Age trackway would have looked like based on other excavations.
Phil, we're ready to lift this.
But the finds in Trench 1 seem to indicate this might have been rather more than just a bridge.
It's in remarkably good condition, isn't it? What is it? Which one is it? Humerus.
Bone is something that's rarely found on the Somerset Levels because normally the soil's too acidic for it to survive.
It's a human upper arm. Yeah.
Is it? The humerus of many animals is more shorter and truncated and far more robust, whereas the human humerus is longer, more elongated.
All right.
But it looks like an adult bone and can also say what side it's from. It's from. I'm just here.
Yeah. All right.
While the archaeologists puzzled over what this bone was doing here, we tried to construct our own trackway across the nearby marsh using nothing but prehistoric materials and tools.
You've got an axe, Antonio, I see. And a lender hand.
Well, this is a noble tree, isn't it?
It certainly is a bit of a beast, isn't it? It's an oak, 200 years old.
The first job, cutting the bark off, gave me a chance to try out my Iron Age axe.
What's that axe like, Tony?
It's very good. I didn't realise it would be anywhere near as sharp as this. We were going to try and split this oak into planks using nothing more than a mallet and a series of wooden wedges.
This is a traditional way of splitting timber like this oak, which has been used from the Neolithic through to the present time, really.
You can see it
probably going along there, but certainly at the end here. Oh, wow. We're opening
right.
We've just got to make sure it keeps running straight to the centre.
Yes.
That's enough of that one.
It's quite scary when you hear it go. You know you don't want it to go too far. The technique was simple enough, but the task itself required more than just patience and brute force. The skill in achieving a decent-sized plank was in deciding when to follow the natural grain of the wood. While I was splitting planks, the archaeologists uncovered what they thought might have been the remains of a platform in Trench 1.
You've got this piece, you see. To point it out, Richard,
this one here.
It looks like a plank fragment that's had a mortise hole cut in it. We've got more fragments of planking up here. We're getting uprights here, so it looks like it is within the structure. It might be a more complex structure, which might not just be a trackway.
You're being cagey. I don't understand what else it could be.
Well, we do know of other prehistoric sites that had lots of piles and lots of wood associated with them, but weren't necessarily just trackways, like Flag Fen.
Yeah.
And what was that?
Well, ritual is always the explanation.
Oh,
back on that again.
I thought Richard was being a bit shifty.
Yeah, well, there it looked as if there was an awful lot of metal objects in a sort of shallow sort of pool, lake or whatever. And it was like as if they'd gone out to this platform and thrown this stuff off the end. There was so much of it, which you might do if you were interested in water deities or something like that. You were making offerings of material to them. Now, we've never had anything like that in this area, but it's a very watery environment, so there's no reason why we shouldn't.
Positively musical, isn't it, eh?
In the marsh, we had enough timber cut and stripped to begin putting in the main posts. It was clearly going to be a case of trial and error.
On the outside.
Okay.
All right.
One, two, three.
Cool, can we? Oh. That ain't gonna go.
No, that ain't there, is it?
Oh, ah.
It's going.
Is it firm at all? Or is it doing anything at all, is it?
I think the problem is they're really fat at the end.
Yeah.
Yeah, so they're roughly pointed. I mean, the only other solution around it is to split some in half and just use the half, one good half.
At the main trench, Jenny was finding more timbers.
There are lots of sort of little fragments of wood in the soil and the water, so we've kept a bag for...
Right, in case there might be shavings or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah.
We're getting down now. We should be able to put it through in a minute.
The trackway was going well now that we were splitting the piles to make them thinner. Each lesson learnt was making progress quicker, like making a small hole first before trying to push the pile in.
There you go, look, there's another lesson. What? Creating these woodworking chips on site.
Oh, and Jenny just found a load of little chips down in the bottom of one of the planks.
Oh, there you go, there it is happening, look.
Right, now what we want you to do now, Tony, is stand on this bit, if you could, hold the top and jump up and down, please. That's the technique. Yeah, this is the this is the technique.
If I fall off, this isn't a wind up.
No.
Not at all.
God, how do I get
as if
up?
We do.
And just jump up and down.
Yeah, jump up
just
and down
jump
on
up
it.
And down.
No, in my way, it's not make any difference.
It's going.
It is going.
Is it?
Yes, it is.
But the question remained, how old were the wooden trackways? Earlier, Mick had sent some samples off for dendrodating.
Have you got anything to tell us?
Yes, I have. Well, I've got dates for all three.
You've got dates for all three?
Yeah.
Great. We are all waiting here. Absolutely agog.
The structure date, I think you're looking at a date of around about, let's say, 900 BC.
Felling date of 900 BC?
Yeah, which is Bronze Age.
Which is late Bronze Age.
Which meant that the worked timbers we'd unearthed were an incredible 3,000 years old. We didn't have the number of uprights needed to support a platform like the one at Flag Fen. What we did have was more like just a line of posts. This suggested that this was a ritual boundary marking the edge of a settlement. Parts of skeletons were deposited here, having been previously laid out to decompose by the water. This could explain why so few bones were discovered. And our own reconstruction of the trackway was finally complete.
Well, it's keeping my feet dry.
I reckon that's a good job. Well done, that is.
It works.
Oh, what do you think then, gentlemen?
I think it's brilliant. Right. I think we can be rightly proud of ourselves over this.
Well, I think we've achieved what we set out to do.
Well, it probably don't look much, but it's functional.
Well, when that's you right. think how far we've got in a day.
And that's starting from scratch.
Yep.
And we've learnt a lot.
We tend to think of London as a city founded by the Romans, but there's evidence that settlement along the banks of the Thames predates the Roman invasion by thousands of years. In 1993, archaeologists found a pair of Bronze Age spearheads on the foreshore near Vauxhall. They were near the remains of a timber structure which also appeared to be prehistoric. The big question was there a connection between the two? Since the Thames revealed the structure in 1993, 22 timbers had been recorded. Carbon dating confirmed that they were up to 3,500 years old. Their pattern suggested that they could be the remains of a building, a jetty, or even a bridge. Although the timbers had survived 3.5 millennia, our dig could have been the last chance anyone had to study them.
The whole reason that we can see the piles today is because the river is eroding the foreshore on top of them. So once the foreshore, which has sealed them for 3,000 years, has been washed away, then the river starts on the piles themselves and it's eating those away as well. So they've only got a limited life.
We started our investigation into this mysterious structure by looking at one post in particular to see what it could tell us about this possible building, jetty or bridge. The top of the one we chose appeared to be in good condition, but the eroding shoreline meant it might not have survived much longer if we didn't remove and preserve it.
Ah! Well, there it is.
That's the edge of your post.
That is the timber.
Yeah.
Different sort of digging, isn't it?
Yeah, nice big timber.
Yeah.
It was a lot of hassle for a very little hole. Mick, that is pathetic. It's got to be the smallest trench we've ever dug on time team. What's the point of that?
Well, there are two reasons, really. One is we're not allowed to dig a big area because this is a sensitive environment. The Environment Agency don't want too many big holes. But secondly, we don't actually need to because this is a hole to get samples from so that we can take them away and work on them in the lab. So it's really a test pit to get environmental samples from. It's more scientific archaeology.
This scientific archaeology included taking some sample cores of what was below the modern foreshore surface.
Unit 8.
Yeah.
Unit 2.
Yep. See this?
In Trench 1, the area around our timber had now caught our attention.
It's got lots and lots of little powdery bits of sand, and this is all clay with wood. So it's just possible.
It looked like we'd found a post hole. This was important evidence as we tried to work out what our structure might be. If we'd got posts, timbers placed in a hole and then packed with earth, then that would have suggested a structure built on dry land. But if they were piles, sharpened timbers driven into the ground, then we could have been looking at a structure built over water. But as the minutes ticked by, the tide continued to drop, revealing a second timber we wanted to investigate.
We need to get the walk boards just outside your half-metre stretch so that we're not churning it up.
Investigating Trench 1 in the time available was pushing us to the limit, but the window of opportunity for Trench 2 broke all time team records.
I've got about 45 minutes, I think, for the tide changes.
And what do you want to try and achieve by then?
Well, we want to find out whether this pile is the same as the one over there in the way that it's been set into the ground. See the tool marks and see how deep it is.
If we can get it out today, is that what we're going to try and do?
No, I'm going to half section it today, and then we can backfill the hole with clean gravel in bags, whip that out tomorrow, and we can carry on down.
Are you confident?
I don't know how deep it is. I honestly don't know. It could be huge.
Phil, the tide's turned.
The tide's turned?
Yeah.
My God,
We haven't really got as far as we'd hoped, have we?
Well, I think we're doing very... I mean, this one is probably as much as we would have hoped. This looked very good.
Well, what can you get from this?
Look, we know now that it is definitely a post. It's not been piled in. Look, we've got this beautiful cut of the actual post hole. So somebody's actually dug a hole and put one of the posts in. That was one of our main objectives, to find that out. We've cracked that.
The clock was also ticking for our lab-based archaeology, but we were getting promising results. First up were the coring samples we took from the Bronze Age level of the foreshore. And I was about to meet some strange creatures called diatoms.
Diatoms, what are they?
They're microscopic algae that are of interest to people who are interested in sediments because they have a silica skeleton which can be preserved. This is a diatom that you find in estuaries between the sea and the top of the tidal head of the river.
So how significant is it that we're on or near the tidal head?
Very significant. This is actually new news. It was only just a few years ago that it was suggested the tidal head was as far upstream as Westminster in the Bronze Age.
Well, we're a few hundred yards upstream from that.
And now we've moved upstream from that, so this is a first for Time Team. We've actually put the tidal head further upstream.
And what does it imply about our structure?
Oh, well, this is important. The tidal head is that point at which the river runs backwards halfway through the day and then forwards again, so it's a very magic place, because that's the point at which vessels can be swept upstream on an incoming tide, can offload their cargoes, and then be swept downstream on the outgoing tide.
So this evidence doesn't tell us what the thing is, but it tells us why it is where it is.
A splendid summary, yes.
Day 2. The tide was out and we were back on the foreshore with the partly excavated post that we'd carefully packed yesterday. But it didn't look good. I think it's moved in the night.
It looks more as if it's further over to me.
Yeah.
Is that all right?
Ish.
Ish.
In fact, it was not all right. As we removed the last gravel bags from the trench, our worst fears had been realised. This was a real disappointment for our diggers, who'd worked harder and faster than they'd ever had to before. But it seemed that there was nothing we could have done to prevent the timber snapping.
Look, it's an incredibly old crack.
Look, I mean, there's no way that would have stayed up. It's already broken.
Yeah.
Our dig concentrated on a claustrophobic 1 square metre trench, but we'd gathered our evidence from locations along a 20-mile stretch of the River Thames. So what did all this information tell us? Well, the oak timbers were piles driven into the Bronze Age foreshore. They may have supported a jetty for votive offerings to a newly tidal river that had dramatically changed the landscape at Vauxhall. But I prefer to think the evidence suggested that they belonged to the oldest known bridge on the Thames. Today, the London foreshore is a mass of concrete and steel. But 3,500 years ago, it would have been lined with reeds, and our walkway would have connected the shore to an island created by the swirling confluence of the Thames and its tributaries.
People are travelling across water on quite a large scale. They're moving across country, they're building bridges, they're building causeways. The whole landscape is opening up, and as people cross water, particularly important stretches of water, it seems that they often made offerings. I don't think it follows that all the walkways are built simply to facilitate offerings, but certainly it made it a lot more feasible.
While our Bronze Age people were building this fantastic edifice into the Thames, what was going on around them in the rest of the world?
Well, rather similar systems. You see, the Thames is only one of a series of major rivers that seem to have great concentrations of Bronze Age activity. Just as you've got a mass of metalwork from the Thames in London, so you've got it again from the Seine in Paris, you've got it from the Rhine. Probably you're dealing with an international network of elites who are exchanging rather similar goods for each other and disposing of them in rather similar ways.
The most visible reminders of the Bronze Age are the henges and burial mounds. And of course, we shouldn't forget the bronze artifacts, whether they were made as everyday tools or as votive offerings. But the more I see of the Bronze Age, the more I realise it didn't have a lot to do with bronze. In our next programme, we'll see if the same's true of iron, when Time Team digs the Iron Age.